eating, the consumption of food. It's something that unites all animals. Animals, including humans, get all of their energy and the materials that they need to make and maintain their bodies by consuming other living organisms or parts of other living organisms. Plants, they don't do this. As you learned earlier, plants photosynthesize, making their own organic molecules, starting out for the most part with only carbon dioxide and water. Plants are autotrophs, or self-feeders. Animals like us, on the other hand, we're heterotrophs, and we need to eat other living things. Eating and acquiring enough nutrition is absolutely critical for an animal's fitness, and there's hardly anywhere in the realm of biology where the link between form and function is so straightforward and obvious than where it comes to an animal's feeding anatomy. You don't need to look inside an animal's stomach in order to know what kind of food it specializes on. In the world of mammals, for example, a quick look at the teeth will tell you if the animal is a carnivore or an herbivore. Cats, big ones and little ones, have spiky teeth. Biologists call this a carnassialized tooth shape because it's good at tearing and slicing carne, meat. Whereas an herbivore like a deer has front teeth, that's right, the incisors, only on the lower jaw, and it uses these incisors together with its rubbery upper lip to clip off leaves from plants. In the back of the deer's mouth, there are big molars that can grind up vegetable matter into a fine pulp. For the carnivore, it's not so important to grind the food into a pulp because meat is much more easily broken down by the kinds of chemical and mechanical digestions that take place in the stomach. Among vertebrates, mammals are unique in having these specialized teeth, molars, premolars, canines, and incisors. Other vertebrates, like an alligator, they tend to have similarly shaped teeth throughout their mouths. Different mammal groups are actually distinguished in part by their dental formulae, how many of each kind of tooth they have in the upper and their lower jaws. In this picture, we're looking at an upper jaw of an animal, and the formula would be I3C1P4M2, meaning that there are 3 incisors, 1 canine, 4 premolars, and 2 molars. And this is just for one side of the upper jaw. Just these numbers alone would identify the skull as belonging to a carnivore, that is, a mammal in the order Carnivora, including dogs, bears, cats, and sea otters, among many others. All of these animals have exactly this number of incisors, canines, etc. And if you have a dog or cat at home that will let you into its mouth, give a look to see if he or she is a true carnivore. And even if we didn't have the whole skull, let's say we only had a tooth or two, we could still tell that this animal ate meat by looking at how carnassialized, that's long and blade-like, the premolars and the molars are. Of course, it's not just mammals that show this distinctive adaptive feeding anatomy. Birds have bills, or beaks, that fit the needs for harvesting the kinds of food items that the bird eats. Fish have gill rakers, or cartilaginous bumps or fibers, on their gills that form a basket that retain food items in the mouth so that they're not lost when the excess water is forced out through the gills. Suspension-feeding fish, like this sardine, have very fine, hair-like gill rakers that form a fine sieve that will capture tiny zooplankton from seawater. Compare this with the gill rakers of a fish that eats large chunks of food. Here are the gill rakers of a sculpin that eats crabs, squid, and other fish. In other words, much bigger things than the plankton feeder. The sculpin is a bulk feeder. We are bulk feeders too, but the sculpin is a bulk feeder, and contrast this with a suspension-feeding sardine. The sculpin's short, knobby gill rakers would not be any good to trap zooplankton, but they do work perfectly well to trap the bigger food that this kind of fish specializes on. Remember that suspension feeding is not limited to small fish either. The largest animals on the whole planet, baleen whales, They're also suspension feeders, as are a huge diversity of invertebrates, such as barnacles and sponges. After being swallowed, food passes further down the digestive tract, where you can see other structural adaptations for specialized diets. Many familiar animals have parts of the digestive tract that you won't find in humans. Chickens, and birds in general, have crops and gizzards where the food gets crushed by muscular walls, and sometimes the animal will even swallow little stones that will stay in the crop and assist with the mechanical breakdown of food. Many herbivores, like the koala, are cecum fermenters, and they have blind compartments off to the side of their intestinal tracts that make it possible to digest nutrients from plant-based foods with the assistance of bacteria, whose tiny size means that they have huge surface area, as well as an ability to penetrate and break down even very bulky food material. Once the bacteria have eaten what the animal couldn't digest, then the animal can derive nutrition by digesting the bacteria. So while we take a primarily human-focused approach in this unit, remember that humans are not the only animal of interest. In a lot of ways, though, humans really are just like any other animal, and so a lesson that's focused on the human digestive anatomy could give us an adequately general perspective. At the same time, and in the broader scope of things, you should also consider that the human digestive system represents only one of the many ways in which animals meet their daily needs for nutrients.